Amen. Thank you. Good morning. It's great to see you for worship today, and happy Easter to you. Today is the third Sunday in the season of Easter, and as I promised last week, I will continue to say happy Easter until we are at Pentecost, which is when Easter season ends. If you are a guest today, we extend an especially warm welcome to you and ask that you please fill out the connection card that's in one of the chairs in front of you. Let us know you're here and we will be in touch with you. And then for all of us, if you have a prayer request or you're looking for some information or you would like for me or someone else to be in touch with you, please use that connection card that looks like this. Drop it in the offering plate or give it to me at the end of the service and we'll be sure to be in touch with you. A few announcements, well actually just one announcement, but it has a few parts to it. Our team is going to Redbird to take furniture and clothing and other supplies that are much needed there in Kentucky, and they are leaving next Sunday, so we will offer a prayer of commissioning over them and safety. And then if you are available to help on Saturday, they need help loading the truck. That will start at 8:30, and I imagine it'll take at least an hour and a half to load that truck. So if you have a good back and you can come and help to load some things in the truck, that is much needed. And then if you don't have a good back, but you can cook or go to the grocery store and buy some fruit or snacks, you could bring that on Saturday for them to enjoy while they're away and serving those that are in need in Kentucky. If you have questions about that, Teo or Betty LaDuke can answer those questions, and I can maybe help you a little bit with that. But let's please support them in those ways. And it's wonderful to be in the house of the Lord today, and let's go to him in a word of prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for this day that you have made. We thank you for this place, both this building that we come to worship you and our beautiful surroundings. May the beauty that you have created be evidenced in us today and in our praise to you. Holy Spirit, come fill us, we pray. Amen.
I got the joy down in my affirmation of faith today is the Apostles' Creed. It's on the overhead. If you would rather have the printed word, it is on page 881 of United Methodist Hymnal. Right now, I ask you, Christians, what do you believe?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
What a wonderful
Amen. While we go out with joy. I said to the choir earlier about something else. We're not on Broadway, so ... But today I think maybe it is like we're on Broadway. That was wonderful. Thank you for that beautiful singing. Let's go to God in a word of prayer. Give him our thanks and our confessions and our praises. Gracious God, we thank you that you have created us with joy, that you have created us with purpose. This world and the people of it can be distractions to us seeking and living into that purpose. So we ask for your help for us to remain focused on you and to spread your love and your joy wherever we go. Lord, in a moment of silence, we offer our confessions with grateful hearts that we are forgiven. Lord, hear our prayers. Remind us that we are loved, that when we find ourselves in difficult situations, you are with us, and you are working all things together for our good. We pray for those who are not feeling well this morning, for those who are finding it difficult to experience joy, for those who need assurance and a reminder that you are God and hold all things in the palm of your hand. Help us in sorrow to look to you. We pray for families who are in mourning today, those who have lost a loved one. We pray for those who you are taking home and for those who are coming into this world. We pray for strength and courage for those who are making difficult decisions. We pray for those who are struggling to keep it all together and ask for your grace and your mercy. Lord, we thank you that you heal our brokenness, and when we offer our sins to you, when we offer ourselves to you, our relationship with you grows ever stronger and empowers us to draw others closer to you. We ask that you continue to bind us together as your church, as your disciples, praying the prayer that you taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Music. Here he comes.
This song today is about Kim. Wish she was here today, but she couldn't be. She's not feeling real well, and she had third chemo Thursday. But we know that she's going to be okay. But I just wanted to say how much we appreciate all the prayers given to her. I know the day back on January 26th, she's having the surgery. You know, she could feel it, and I could feel it. Just the peace that we've had in going through what she's going through now. Peace knowing that God is with us. But we just thank you all so much for your prayers, and what a blessing this church has been to us and our family for all these years.
Thank you.
Somebody's praying, I can feel it. Somebody's praying for me. Mighty hands are guiding me to protect me from what I can't see. Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. Somebody's praying for me. Angels are watching, I can feel 'em. Angels are watching over me. There's many miles ahead till I get home, so I'm safely kept before your throne. 'Cause Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. Your angels are watching over me. Well, I've walked the barren wilderness where my pillow was a stone, and I've been through the darkest caverns where no light has ever shone. Still I went on, 'cause there was someone who was down on their knees. Lord, I thank you for these people praying all this time for me. Somebody's praying, I can feel it. Somebody's praying for me. Mighty hands are guiding me to protect me from what I can't see. Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe. Somebody's praying for me. Somebody's praying for me.
And thank you, Roy. This morning, our focus is fitting for that song. And definitely because of prayer, but also because of the spirit that Roy and Kim exude from them, no matter what's going on in their lives. Yes. A spirit of joy that is contagious. And this morning we'll explore the second fruit of the Spirit, which is joy. Extra points for shouting out the first one. Love, yay, good for you. For those of you who heard the sermon last week, how did you do with showing love this past week? Were you able to express it in a sacrificial way? If you were, tell somebody about it. I experienced it, and as is often the case, the sermons speak to me as much as to anyone else. I was in Canton last week, and had planned not to do something concerning my daughter because I didn't feel like she deserved it. And God spoke to me and said, that is not sacrificial love. And I followed through with what it was that I was not going to do. And she doesn't know it. I mean, she doesn't know that I wasn't going to do it. But it made a difference in my day and in the way I thought about that fruit of the Spirit. And then we also talked about how we use that word love just sort of casually. I don't know about you, but I caught myself numerous times saying I love something that probably really wasn't a good way to use that word. As I mentioned last week, we're seeking to take these fruits of the Spirit heart. And not only to take them by heart, but to learn this scripture by heart so that we can be reminded at a moment's notice what it is to have the fruits of the Spirit when we're in our car in Canton to be able to say, love is a fruit of the Spirit and God has empowered me and called me to express that fruit. So let's follow along and recite as many as we can, the fruits of the Spirit, what the Holy Spirit produces in us. And I'm going to look at them so I don't screw y'all up. But by the end of this series, we're all going to be able to say these fruit of the Spirit by heart, right? Okay, so here we go. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Very good. The teachers in the bunch know that quite well. 9 fruit of the Spirit, beginning with the spirit of love, which is the foundation to all of these spirits. And the next one is joy. I love the word joy, and yes, I mean love. It puts a smile on my face. It brings a sweet spirit. And the only context that I can think of that word joy is not uplifting is the lack of joy. We often call our youngest daughter Joyful Jill. She's a joy to be around. Joy is an expression of Christ within us. And our scripture today speaks to that. It's professed by David, and it's an expression of his love for God and his joy that accompanies a deep relationship with God. And his exhortation is all for all to proclaim and to express. So as you're able, would you stand for the reading of God's word this morning from Psalm 100? Verses 1-3. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Thank you for joining me in that reading today. That was just spontaneous. I loved it. I asked for you to stand, but hey, I'm anytime you want to express and proclaim the word of God, please do. Joy. It's been said that joy is the ability to adjust to circumstances beyond our control. This is not resignation, it's faith. As Christians, we have faith that the Lord is God, that the Lord is good, and that he holds all things in his hands, and that we belong to him, so we shout for joy, even and especially when things aren't going well. As we know, King David's circumstances were not always easy or happy or good. Yes, he was royalty, and that came with a lot of luxury and things, but it also came with great responsibility and great stress and hardship at every turn. Yet because of his deep relationship with God, he was able to find and truly experience joy. How does he do so? How do we do so? The scripture tells us, by worshiping the Lord with gladness, by offering joyful songs, by knowing God, and by finding joy in knowing who we are as a result of knowing God. In other words, we experience joy by being in close relationship with Christ and by focusing our attention on him. As soon as David looked to his own interests, you know the story, you know what happened. Rather than worshiping and focusing on God, he got himself in trouble. He got what he wanted in the moment, but he suffered dearly later as a result. Maybe you've experienced that. I have. The first few years of our marriage, Mike and I designed and built our dream home. We sold our first house that we had after 3 years for double the amount of money that we paid for it. And so we thought it a good investment to put that money into the next house. So I went to work as the interior designer that I was, drawing plans and picking out finishes and making it just perfect. I won't speak for Mike, as he's never seemed to care a whole lot about where we live or what we live in or what it looks like. He's really good about the outside. He takes care of all of that. But I was consumed with this house. It was on 5 acres, and it had a combined living room and dining room that could hold 60 people for an event. Even for a fashion show with a runway down the middle. That's the story for another day. I got what I wanted, and it was great for a season, but it became quickly evident that we were in way over our heads. As we all know, not so much the house that costs the money, but what comes after that, the upkeep. What I thought would bring us joy did not, because I was looking in the wrong place. Maybe you can relate. Maybe you thought there was a car that would be just the thing for you. A vacation house. A marriage. A baby. A woman. A man. Maybe a trip of a lifetime. Something that would bring you joy. A career, a new cell phone. We giggle at some of these things, but every one of these things has been sought after to bring joy by someone. Getting what we want might bring us happiness for a season, but eventually we come to the realization that things and even people don't necessarily bring us joy. The pursuit of happiness rarely brings us joy, but God's joy frequently brings us happiness. Joy is based on the Spirit, while happiness is based on circumstances. In fact, the word happiness derives from the English word happenstance, which means something that happens because of our circumstance. We often complain about what's happening in our world. that it's worse than it's ever been. And this perception brings us disappointment, discontentment, and sometimes even fear. I think this gets more pronounced as we get older. But if we look back, there have been many terrible times in our history. In the 1600s, there was a war called the 30-Year War. Can you imagine? An entire generation for those times. In 1636, about 18 years into this war, a German pastor named Martin Rinkert officiated 5,000 funerals in 1 year, about 14 per day. I can't even imagine. Yet in the midst of this terrible time, he wrote a prayer that you may recognize as a hymn that we sing at times. Now thank we all our God with hearts and hands and voices, who wondrous things has done, in who his world rejoices. Remember that definition of joy being the ability to adjust to things beyond our control? This is not only an adjustment, it's a shout for joy. And it has nothing to do with happiness or circumstance, but everything to do with faith. The evil one is relentless and will seek to convince us that when our circumstances are dire, we should take matters into our own hands or blame others or even blame God. However, it's hard for Satan to tempt a believer to focus on all that's wrong in this world when they're living in the joy of the Lord. Fruit of the Spirit is joy. We know of other expressions of joy offered to God in the midst of tragedy. The song Amazing Grace, written by a man who experienced salvation and forgiveness, a total change of heart in the midst of slave trafficking. It Is Well, written following the death of a man's entire family. After losing his 5-year-old daughter in a tragic accident at their home, Stephen Curtis Chapman, a contemporary Christian singer, wrote, "I've walked the valley of death's shadow, so deep and dark that I could barely breathe. I've had to let go of more than I could bear and question everything that I believe. But still, even here in this great darkness, a comfort and hope come breaking through as I can say, in life and death, God, we belong to you." What makes these expressions of joy possible in awful circumstances? The saving grace of God and a relationship with him, knowing, believing that people are praying, knowing and trusting that he is good, that he is present, that he is at work. One of Napoleon's generals was tasked with taking over a small Austrian town. They had no means of defense, or very little. Yet the general appeared with 18,000 men. The town council had decided to simply surrender when the pastor of the church reminded them that it was Easter and perhaps they needed to worship and that they should hold services as usual. To worship and to leave a situation beyond their control to God. They did just that. And the French army, hearing the joyful bells ringing, concluded that the Austrian army had been called and was coming to the town's rescue. So they broke camp, and before those bells even stopped ringing, they had vanished. When we shout for joy, when we worship with gladness, when we sing joyful songs and ring joyful bells to God's glory, especially in the face of pain, sickness, fear, loneliness, sorrow, tragedy, the enemy will flee and the victory will be ours. For no enemy is quite as strong as faith accompanied by joy. Joy springs from a faith within, from the fruit that the Holy Spirit gives to us, and from our relationship with Christ. Jesus says in John 15:11, I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. If our joy is complete in Christ, we will shout for joy. If we're looking for joy in other places, we will surely not find it. The joy of the Lord is not positive thinking. It's not necessarily a bubbly personality, although that's helpful at times. It's not getting what we want or the result of everything going our way. Joy is Christ in us, us in Christ, and our choice to express His joy in authentic and contagious ways. William Barclay says, and I quote, the Christian is a person of joy. A gloomy Christian is a contradiction of terms. And nothing in all religious history has done Christianity more harm than its connection with black clothes and long faces. Walk through a busy airport sometime or down a city street and look at the faces of people and observe how much joy there is. Our generation has more opportunities for entertainment, for amusement, more places to go, more things to do, more access to fun than any time in history, yet have we seen an increase in joy? Psalm 16:11 says, in your presence is fullness of joy. Perhaps that's where we're missing the mark. If we want complete joy, if we want to share complete joy, then we need to embrace and live into the presence of Christ. We need to choose joy and then shout to the Lord all the earth. Over and over again, from the mouth of Jesus, from the pen of Job and David and Paul and John, clear instructions emerge. Those who trust in and follow after Christ will experience authentic joy in their lives. No matter what our circumstances or situation, Christ is in us. And if we are in Christ, joy will be present. And no one and no thing can steal that joy from us. No person, no circumstance, not even Satan. Habakkuk 3:17-18. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. Joy is not about good circumstances. It's about great faith in a great God. It's about knowing that the Lord is God and that it is He who made us and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Will that bring us joy? You bet it will. A sense of identity and belonging cannot be bought, and it can't be fully realized anywhere other than in a relationship with Jesus Christ. you're missing that relationship, reach out to someone. Let me know. Joy comes with a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's a fruit of the Spirit that the Holy Spirit produces in us. So how might God be calling you to express joy this week? You're not sure? Pray about it. Same instruction as last week. Ask God to show you how to express joy. And then be ready to follow through with it. Sometimes joy is a shout. Sometimes it's unspeakable, as witnessed in 1 Peter. Christ, whom, having not seen you love, in him, though now you see him not, yet believe, you rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. So perhaps God is leading you to express joy in an unspeakable way. Maybe by smiling all week long. Try it and see how that affects you and how it affects others around you. I can be in a store and have someone that I have no idea who they are smile at me, and it lifts my spirit, and I think joy, and I offer that joy back. And I've heard it said that smiling is good for our health, that it relieves stress. Charles Spurgeon, the famous prince of preachers, says this about joy. There's a marvelous medicinal power in joy. Most medicines are distasteful, especially back then in his day. There was no cherry. But joy, which is the best of all medicines, is sweet to the taste and comforting to the heart. This blessed joy is very contagious. One downcast spirit brings a kind of plague into the house. One person who is wretched seems to stop all the birds from singing wherever he goes. But the grace of joy is contagious. Holy joy will oil the wheels of your life's machinery. Holy joy will strengthen you for your daily labor. Holy joy will beautify you and give you an influence over the lives of others. May it be so. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the church. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. And then bear fruit by sharing fruit. For this, my friends, is what it is to live by the Spirit of joy. Let us pray. Lord God of all joy, I ask that you would lay on the heart of each and every one of us at least one way that we might show and share your joy this week. Give us spirits that reflect a deep trust and faith in your plan and in your care for us and for all you have created. Help us not to be wretched or downcast, but to be contagious as we lift our lives to you. For all that you hold in your hands and for empowering us to carry on your mission, we give you thanks and praise and glory. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we offer our prayer. Amen. repeat the sounding joy, for it is the joy of the Lord that we have been empowered with. You are sent in the name of Jesus. Amen.